We are live. We are live and good afternoon, everyone. Today is the last Sunday after the Epiphany.
Yeah.
And it is also Transfiguration Sunday. It is also the last Sunday in the calendar of February, and also the last Sunday before the season of Lent.
Yes.
We are at the threshold, I believe, a liminal space. I wanted to thank Sandy for taking care of the service last Sunday, for leading and preaching. Thank you very much. Some of you know my mother-in-law died, and we had planned to be at her service last Saturday out of town. That actually got rescheduled. So I took a little retreat weekend, went away to the woods, spent some time in prayer and silence. It was wonderful. And thanks to my brother and his wife for letting me use their place for that. Turning this on might make a difference? No? Try again. On. Does that make a difference? That's on. All right. Very good. First announcement I'll start with is that there are printed copies of the April newsletter. Thanks to Elizabeth. There are printed copies on our table out in the hall. They were emailed out by Paula this past week, so I think most of you have probably seen it in PDF. And didn't bring a copy of my other announcements. But the ones for today are different from the ones in the newsletter. For instance, I realized that though I had told you all about our Lenten study, I haven't mentioned that it's not just our Lenten study. We're sharing it. So it's actually it was first conceived of by Reverend Monique at Julian North, and she's invited ourselves, Faith Lutheran, City View United, and possibly some others to share the study. So Tuesdays at 7, all through the season of Lent, right through the Holy Week and the week after, maybe. The question that the study is looking at is, who is your neighbor? There'll be videos shown from the UK, but they are international, and then small groups. Monique, myself, Martin, and the other United Minister, Deacon Elizabeth, and others, one of the wardens from Julian, will take turns leading, opening the session and leading the session so that we share. We share leadership. Oh. And Ash Wednesday, this Wednesday at 10 o'clock, there will be a service here. The service here, I'm sharing with Carla. It's been put together based on our prayer book with a shared blessing at the end. Next year, we decided Carla will put it together and I will accompany her. Lent, of course, is a season of discipline, of self-examination, of Bible reading and prayer and fasting and almsgiving. We move into a season that has also been called a season of spring cleaning. So we start in the winter on the first or second day of March, and by the time we get to Easter, our spring will be here, and the joy of the Lord will be seen in the budding of the flowers and the blooming of the trees? Sure. Other announcements have to do with our COVID protocols. Today, starting last Sunday, I think, we're allowed to sing through our masks. So that's wonderful. Little differences will happen each week. So starting next Sunday the 6th, readers can take their masks off. I can take my mask off while I'm presiding. And also, we're allowed to have sort of a gathering after. We wanted to have a coffee hour, but we're not allowed to have food and drink. So we can have a receiving line, you know, shake hands or something. So slowly but surely, things are opening up. As you probably have heard, businesses are allowed not to ask for proof of vaccination starting this week, although some businesses will still ask. That's what I remember that I've written in the announcements this week. Oh, except also on Wednesday, 10 o'clock, Ash Wednesday service in the daytime. At 7 p.m. Wednesday night, we're going to, Carla and I are going to be outside with our ashes and do drive-through ashes. So we will have prepared a blessing. You can bring your whole family. Just pull up to one of us. You can have ashes placed on you and have a little prayer prayed over you. We haven't widely advertised that yet. We're going to talk about it tomorrow and maybe get the word out a little bit. I don't expect we'll be out there for more than half an hour, which is good because it's 7:30 and I want to come back in here for Compline, our first Lenten Compline service. You're all welcome to that as well. Any other announcements from the community? Okay. Our service then for this last Sunday of the Epiphany, the Transfiguration of the Lord, begins with the landing knowledge. I invite you to stand. Dear friends, we gather this day on the traditional unceded territory of the Algonquin Nation. May we always dwell on this land with respect and peace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbors. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Now let us pray. Almighty God, on the holy mount you revealed to chosen witnesses your well-beloved Son, wonderfully transfigured. Mercifully deliver us from the darkness of this world and change us into his likeness from glory to glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
And you may be seated for the readings.
A reading from Exodus. Moses came down from Mount Sinai. As he came down from the mountain with the two tablets of the covenant in his hand, Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone, because he had been talking with God. Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, the skin of his face was shining, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the leaders of the congregation returned to him, and Moses spoke with them. Afterward, all the Israelites came near, and he gave them in commandment all that the Lord had spoken with him on Mount Sinai. When Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil on his face. But whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he would take the veil off until he came out. And when he came out and told the Israelites what he had been commanded, the Israelites would see the face of Moses, that the skin of his face was shining. And Moses would put the veil on his face again until he went in to speak with him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Practice cunning or to falsify God's word, but by the
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Now about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James and went up the mountain, on the mountain, to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. And they kept silent, and in those days told no one any of the things they had seen. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Now I speak to you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. Well, there's lots being said in the readings today. The Feast of the Transfiguration of the Lord is a movable feast. It works here the last Sunday before Lent, showing us God's glory and reflecting God's glory. Showing us God's glory reflected in God's people. It also invites us to live in faith, that we may grow more Christ-like, praising the Lord, and in all we do, in word or deed, giving thanks to the glory of the Lord. We heard of Moses putting the veil over his face so that he would avoid overwhelming the people with God's reflected glory. The hymn some of us sang, is a hymn of praise to God who has helped people in need. God who has revealed to us the good news. God who forgives, God who loves. We heard that God loves what is right. And some of you remember in the Psalms in the prayer book, there's always a printed prayer after them. Now, those aren't as ancient as the Psalms, but they're pretty ancient, some of them. The prayer that is in the BAS for after that Psalm includes the request that God's Spirit might lead us in righteousness, that we may live to praise Him. We might live to praise God. The second reading from Paul in one of his letters to the Corinthians contrasts his ministry to Moses. You hear it right away, you know, the veiling and the not veiling. And it points to our ministry, the ministry of each and every one of us, turning to the Lord with unveiled faces, with courage, the courage that our faith can give us, the boldness we can pray for, that we might have freedom from hard-heartedness, freedom from despair. Christ's death on the cross saves us, that we might grow more Christ-like, that we might continue to grow in faith, that we might change. Change, which happens whether we mean it to or not. stand on the threshold not only because we're going to turn the page in the calendar, but because of where we stand in our diocese as a church, in the world. I mean, there always will be crises, difficulties, emergencies. And let's recognize that we as people of faith, as the church, are always called to respond to the world as we find it. March is coming, the third year of the worldwide pandemic. I heard a radio show from March or May of the first year of the pandemic, when we used to talk about flattening the curve. Remember, we were trying to flatten the curve. Now, what are we doing now? We're still keeping each other safe. We're coming out of it, and our call, I suppose, is to keep practicing those protocols that keep us safe. For the first time since 19—I didn't write it down. I remember seeing the newspaper headlines when the Gulf War started. Russia and Belarus attacked the Ukraine. The world is at war. We can't, I can't, you can't stop the war. But you can pray for peace. Practice peace. We can do our part. I have a list, right? The environment, the authoritarianism versus democracy, rising costs of gas. I don't know what to do about that. Maybe drive less? I don't know. Where we spend the money we earn has to do with our faith. The way we speak up against injustice has to do with our faith. The way we do our part to not damage the environment, I think it's part of our faith. I pray for mercy. And I believe with God's help that we can change where we fall short. You know, we're being called to change all the time, to become more Christ-like, to build the kingdom of God on this earth. And we're called specifically right now, our generation, as Bishop Shane says, to give shape to the future of our diocesan church, recognizing that the Holy Spirit is there ahead of us, calling us into a future that we don't see the shape of yet. Some of us like to picture a future church that looks a lot like the church we grew up in. But those days are gone. They're gone. As Bishop Shane has said, we live in structures and systems that have been in place since World War II or earlier, and the context has changed almost completely. We are a small minority in a plural, secular context. We can't just put up a church, slap an Anglican sign on front of it, and expect Anglicans to fill it. We need to change the way we think about our parish ministries and the way we act from our thinking. We will, in the next few years, see changes to the structures and operations of our parish ministry. I know Peter, James, and John on that mountaintop experienced, sensed their friend they had walked with in a new way, in beauty and truth. And immediately, dear Peter wanted to hang on. There's comfort, right? I think we've all been there. We've been on holiday and thought, why do we live in the cold north of Ottawa? We should move here,
We've been, I know I've done that. Or been in a, I remember floating in the river. The sun shining. I had a friend that didn't want to swim with me, but was lifeguarding me. I'm thinking, this is it. Let's just pitch a tent and stay here. There's comfort in that. And even if we can't go back, we can't stay on those mountaintop places, there's comfort in returning to old habits when things are hard, and we're living through hard times. Moving forward in a new way is hard. Bishop Shane is praying for us, and I pray that we may all have courage and faith, that we might have confidence. New things are required of us. We've done well. Some new things will be required of us as we move forward. As we move forward. One of the lectures, I'll finish that sentence in a second. One of the lectures that the diocese put out was on the climate change and signs of hope. There was a psychologist, an economist, a lawyer, and someone from an indigenous community who'd done work in justice, things like that. There was a lot of interesting things that came out of the panel discussion, but one of the things that I've been looking at has to do with the psychologist listed all sorts of reasons why people might not want to participate in practices and habits that might help us to counter climate change's effects. And I've been thinking about these ways that we stop ourselves from changing when we're called to change. And they're in many categories. So I'll just give you a few. I've heard people say, I'm not able to do this because I'm not physically able. I'd like to say, you have a part to play. People say, I don't want to change, I'm fine with the way things are. The way things are is not sustainable, and so we need to change. We might say, I have other things to work on, more important goals. Maybe you do. Maybe you don't like to be forced to change. Well, I don't like to be forced to change either. But we've known about this. If you Google churches need to change or something like that, you can find articles going back to the 1995, 1990, even farther back, they said. Farther back. We needed to change. There are risks, and there is a reward. There is a reward at the end. We are, each of us, as Lewis wrote in Learning in Wartime, we are, each of us, daily moving toward heaven or hell. We are all on our way. Transfiguration Sunday is another epiphany of the Lord, another showing, another revelation of Jesus. Why not look at your own going forward and think about what needs to change in you?
friends, Peter, James, and John, saw him speak with the lawgiver and the prophet. They sensed, they knew his glory. And Peter, always the first one out of the boat, always the first one to open his mouth, always, he didn't know what he was saying, and that's always a nice thing, I think, in the Bible, when we see him make a silly mistake, because we all make mistakes, and he was one of Jesus' closest friends. Jesus doesn't turn his back on us when we make mistakes. I think another thing about the transfiguration is they didn't listen to Jesus saying something. They sensed it. They saw it. Jesus comes to us. The Holy Spirit comes to us in our desires, in our senses. We are able to see the goodness of God, able to sense the goodness of God in nature, in each other, in our desires to feast. We don't stay happy all the time. We don't always stay up on the mountaintop bathed in glorious light. We come down off the mountain. We live lives of undulation. We have highs and lows, and the church recognizes that. Sundays are feast days. We have seasons of fasting. That's life. We are given special times of joy we might remember that prepare us and strengthen us for the challenges that will follow. And all the better if we can let those joyful mountaintop experiences lead us to showing practical love to those around us when we get back down to level ground. I imagine Peter and James and John, but they didn't tell anyone about their experience. Kept thinking about it. And they kept listening to Jesus. They followed him all the way to Jerusalem, beyond Golgotha to their own martyrdoms. Epiphany has left us with some dazzling visions. The great and majestic and awesome God, our wonderful Lord. We are part of God's good, very good creation. God made. Not our own, but bought with a price. Bought with a price. And the glory of the Lord is beyond us. Beyond my words, beyond mortal flesh. The peace of God is beyond human understanding. The love of God is ineffable and is real. More real than the bad news on the news. More real than the pain in your back, the grief in your heart, the anxiety in your weak days. Jesus heals, comes down from the mountain and into the needy world. His power heals, his faithfulness continues. And I invite you to look for signs of beauty and truth and faith. Be astounded. Feast on Tuesday, fast on Wednesday. Come and be invited in Jesus' name to observe a holy Lent. And I'll remind you again, each Sunday is a feast day of the Lord. So if you abstain from anything during Lent, feast on it on Sundays in the name of the Lord. Seek to live in the light of God's glory. God meets us where we are. Thank you, Lord, for visions of glory and the hope we have of eternal life. to you be honor and glory and thanksgiving now and forever. Amen.
In the silence of our hearts, or in spoken words, let us give thanks for the gift of this day and pray for the life of the world. In the Anglican Church, we pray for the Right Reverend John Gordon, Bishop, and the clergy and people of the Diocese of Western Newfoundland. In the Lutheran Church, we pray for the Dean, Council, and congregations of the Georgian, Huronia, and Bay areas of the Eastern Synod. In the Anglican Diocese, we pray for the Anglican Fellowship of Prayer and Paul Dunro, the Alcohol Representative, and for all parish representatives. We pray for all parish administrators in our diocese, and especially for our own Paul. We pray for Martin Luther Lutheran Church and their pastor, Judith Kirsch. We pray for Shane, our bishop, Anne, our metropolitan, and Linda, our primate. We pray for Mark, our national indigenous bishop. We pray for our companion diocese, the Diocese of Jerusalem, and their Archbishop Hosen, and the Lutheran national bishop, Susan, and the bishop of the Eastern Synod, Michael. In our parish prayers, we pray for our families, and the people with whom we live and work, and we pray for the people of Ukraine. In this prayer for the people of Ukraine that was sent out by the Archbishop Justin Volby and Archbishop Stephen Cottrell and forwarded to us by our own Bishop Shane, God of peace and justice, we pray for the people of Ukraine today. We pray for peace and the laying down of weapons. We pray for all those who fear for tomorrow, that your spirit of comfort would draw near to them. We pray for those with power over war or peace, for wisdom, discernment, and compassion to guide their decisions. Above all, we pray for all your precious children, at risk and in fear, that you would hold and protect them. We pray this in the name of Jesus, the Prince of Peace.
Amen.
This morning I'll be using our prayer litany number 3, if you happen to have a BAS handy. It's on page 112. Let us offer our prayers to the source of all love and all life, saying, Lord, hear our prayer. Merciful God, we pray for all who call themselves Christians, that we may become a royal priesthood, a holy nation, to the praise of Christ Jesus, our Savior. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for Shane, our bishop, and for all bishops and other ministers. We pray that they may remain faithful to their calling and rightly proclaim the word of truth. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for Elizabeth, our queen, for the leaders of the nations and all in authority, that your people may lead quiet and peaceable lives. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for the city of Ottawa and those who live here, the poor and the rich, the elderly and the young, men and women, that you will show your goodwill to all. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for the victims of our society and those who minister to them, that you will be their help and defense. And at this point, we will pray for those who ask for our prayers. We pray for Hope, Peter, Heather, Jennifer, Shannon, Tom, and family. Kaylee, Karen, Owen, the Smith family, Dorothy, Linda, Chrissy, and Luz. Valerie and Kareem, Jacob, Krista, Peter, and Michael. Norma R., Connie, Paula, Annette, Rosemary, Anita, Inez, Sheila, Robbie, Andrea K., Margaret, Elizabeth, Doreen Akers, Angela, and Trent. Let's take a moment, either in silence or by spoken word, to pray for those who are in each of our hearts. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for those preparing for baptism or for those who recently baptized, that they may be strengthened in the faith. Lord, hear our prayer. We give thanks for all the saints who have found favor in your sight from earliest times, prophets, apostles, martyrs, and those whose names are known to you alone. And we pray that we too may be counted among your faithful witnesses. Lord, hear our prayer. For the gift of our life and each life, thanks be to you, God. Open our hearts to gratitude, free our minds from greed, heal our lives with grace, and awaken our souls again to generosity.
Thank you.
Holy God, receive all we offer you this day, and bring us to that radiant glory which we see in the transfigured face of Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of heaven and earth, because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give knowledge of salvation in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Now with angels and archangels and the whole company of heaven, we lift our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We give thanks to you, Lord our God, for the goodness and love you have made known to us in creation. In calling Israel to be your people, in your words spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the Word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, a death he freely accepted, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, Father, according to his command, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we, made acceptable in him, may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ and make them new, and bring us to that city of light where you dwell with all your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
We being many are one body, for we all share in the one bread.
Dear friends, I invite you in this moment, wherever you may be, to receive Christ in communion with the saints and the gathering of God's people, unseen and yet present with us now. Many are made one. We receive you, Lord Jesus Christ, We welcome your presence in us, and together proclaim our love for you. With our hearts, minds, our souls, and our strength, with the saints we worship you, with the angels we adore you, with your whole church we proclaim your reign. Come to us, O many, and make us one in you. Amen. And for those present, the gifts of God, for the people of God.
Thank you, God.
Holy God, we see your glory in the face of Jesus Christ. May we who are partakers of his table reflect his life in word and deed, that all the world may know his power to change and save. We ask this in his name. Amen. Glory to God, whose power is working in us and do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. And may God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, three persons in one God, inspire you to live as one, that you may witness to the perfect unity of his love. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and always. Amen. Our God is an awesome God.
Peace to love and serve the Lord.